Thank everybody for coming out. We'll do formal introductions in just a couple minutes. Do you mind if we warm up? I mean, because the weather's been like so up and down, my sinuses don't know if they've got a cold or I have allergies. All right, we're going to do a little song from a Broadway musical from about 10 years ago for us. Because for us, it's 1944. Okay, at least it will be 1944 at 2 o'clock, right? Okay. So anyway, if I can impose upon my faithful Indian companion, Bubba.
Pennies from heaven, you'll find your fortune falling all over town. Make sure your umbrella is upside down. Trade them for a package of sunshine and flowers if you want. The things you love, you must have showers. So when you hear it thunder, don't you run under a tree. There'll be pennies from heaven for you and me.
Stay with me.
Pennies from heaven. From heaven, you'll find your fortune falling all over town. Make sure your umbrella is upside down. Trade them for a package of sunshine and flowers if you want. The things you love, you must have showers. So when you hear it thunder, don't you run under a tree. There'll be pennies from heaven for you and me.
How's that for an intro for you, Grace Mary? Oh, thank you so much. There she is, your indomitable, abominable, inimitable Grace Mary Gray.
Thank you. That's the best introduction we've ever had. My name is Grace Mary Brady. I'm with the Bayside History Museum. And this program is brought to you today from our Calvert Libraries and our Bayside History Museum in a cooperative effort. I'd like to introduce two of our town elected officials, our mayor, Mayor Mark Frazier. The audiovisual cameraman is actually one of our town council members, and he does double duties, and he's always here to support all of our different lectures, and we so appreciate it. Mickey Hummel, you want to
thank you.
So without further ado today, we're going to have our program. Mr. Turner is going to talk to you a little bit of the history of this, and then he's going to sing. And here's one of our former directors of our Calvert Library, always with us, Pat. Thank you for coming out today. And please, housekeeping, turn off your cell phones. This is being recorded, so you might not want to have a conversation that you don't want recorded. So now, are we ready? This is the father and son team of Vince and Vincent Turner, whose stage names are Spam and Bubba.
Yippee-yay, there'll be no wedding bells for today. The
If I got spurs that jingle, jingle,
jingle,
as I go riding merrily along, and they say, oh, ain't you glad you're single? And that song hits so very far from Rome. Oh, Lily Bell, oh, Lily Bell. Though they have done some fooling, this is why I never fell. If I got spurs that jingle, jingle,
jingle,
as I go riding merrily along. And they say, ooh, ain't you glad you're single?
Jingle, jangle.
And that song, it's so very far from home.
Jingle, jangle.
Well, we want to thank everybody for coming out this afternoon. Want to thank the Bayside History Museum, the Calvert Library Association, and the citizens of Calvert County for their continued support for the shows that Bubba and I put on together. We were here a couple years ago with Entertaining the Troops 1. We didn't know there would be a 2, but we came back anyway. And our first show, we emphasized the civilian part of Entertaining the Troops during the Second World War, the USO and Camp Shows Inc. Today we have a brand new presentation for you. It's called Entertaining the Troops 2, and it focuses on the Army Special Service Companies of World War II. Sometime today, if you get a chance, please go over to the table. We have a number of artifacts that are related to today's presentation. Again, thank you so much for being here. I hope you enjoy the show. I got spurs that jingle, 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 as I go riding merrily along. And they say, ooh, ain't you glad you're single? And that song hits so very far from home. Oh, Lily Bell, oh, Lily Bell. Though they have done some fooling, this is why I never fell. If I got spurs that jingle, jangle, jingle, as I go riding merrily along. And they say, ooh, ain't you glad you're single? And that song hits so very far from home. Well, the Army Special Services Division was formed under the Office of the Adjutant General on July 22, 1940. Prior to that, during World War I, most of the entertainment that was provided to our troops and the U.S. military were done by private organizations such as the Red Cross and the YWCA. Now, during the war, Special Services got bounced around quite a little bit, They got moved under the Director of Personnel, they got moved under Morale and Welfare, and then unfortunately, they were disbanded in 1950. Though if you were a Korean War era veteran or a veteran of the Vietnam era, you do recall, or you may recall, that they did have special services units in country in conjunction with the USO. And I see some heads nodding out there, all right? Completely different organization, by the way, okay? So now that we've talked about the division and its origins, let's talk about the special service companies themselves. All right, we're independent, we're self-sustaining, okay? That means once we ship out, we're pretty much on our own. Bub and I are both members of the 34th Special Services Company. Right now we're serving over in occupied France. We just happened to be in town today, so we figured we'd stop by and tell you a little bit about what we're doing. Yeah, we don't get leave very often, trust me. All right, we could be assigned anywhere within the military structure, at the division level, the battalion level. We are normally assigned to the headquarters company. Why is that? They want to keep an eye on us, okay? You don't want a bunch of guys running around with a bunch of equipment, just pretty much on the run. However, there are very strict rules for what we do. Anybody that's ever been in the military, especially the older military members, that there were technical manuals and field manuals. We have to read every one. We actually have to go to school for what we do, okay? And we get tested once a year. As a matter of fact, Bubba just got out of tech school in January, so let's give him a big hand. So in addition to entertainment, a lot of people ask me, I'm gonna talk while you read the slides, because I hate just reading slides.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. But there's a lot of good information here. We're gonna cover all of it, okay? when we talk about entertainment, especially when it comes to the U.S. military, a lot of people think about Bob Hope and USO. But here's the deal, all right? Special services companies provided entertainment. They also did other things such as run canteens and exchanges in the field. And that's a little twist that most people don't know about. So we were rather diverse. We have our own motor company. We have to transport 109 men plus equipment all over Europe. Matter of fact, we got off somewhere, I think it was in Bristol, England, immediately hopped on a ship the following day and got dropped somewhere in France that I can't tell you about because I'd have to kill myself. We also, believe it or not, even though we're entertainers and we're theatrical people and we run the newspaper for the camp, we are trained as infantry. We did have to pass basic training, okay, and we are equipped. I didn't bring my weapon with me today because there are rules within the town limits about weapons. But we are trained as infantry, and we have actually defended our position before when they overran our radio station. Okay, so moving on. What we're going to do is we're going to break this down. Now, in 1942, the Army actually began drafting people with talent. So you sort of kind of had to have talent. You couldn't just show up and say, I want to be in special services. You had to sing, dance, act, have a background in some type of management. You could be a cook and be in special services, and we have 6 truck drivers. So if you have one of those special talents and you see something you like today, let me know. We'll see if we can recruit you. All right? Now, there was a school up in Fort Meade. Everybody knows what Fort Meade is?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the Army Special Services School was there. One of the famous alumni of the school, you're going too quick, was Captain Glenn Miller. Glenn Miller was actually in the Army Air Forces during the war and graduated from Fort George Meade. Okay? Mainly, the idea was that in addition to being an infantryman, you had to have the advanced training. This is where you actually learned that there's only three ways of doing things. I'll be able to say that soon. All right. Say it with me if you know it. There's the right way, the wrong way, and the army way. All right. Later on, the school for the officers moved down to Fort Lee in Virginia, but the enlisted men still went through Fort Lee through the end of the war. So one of my favorite pictures that Grace Mary wanted to show you, this is an actual photograph from the Special Services School where the guys are learning how to swim. And here's a little tidbit for you. Even though he didn't serve in World War II, one of the most famous alumni of the Special Services is Clint Eastwood. He was a lifeguard. So he didn't go to Fort Meade because he missed the Second World War, but the Army told him how to swim. Moving on. Okay, the organization. As everybody knows, the Army's very organized, right? Wink, wink, nod, nod. All right. So in a special services company, you had the company headquarters, which was the captain and all of his cadre and staff. And then you had what were called platoons, and the platoons were broken down into 3 sections. Each of the platoons within the company were the same. So basically you had a headquarters cadre, and then you had 4 platoons doing the same type of work. The reason for that was if you were working around a large encampment, you wanted to make sure that everybody was able to avail themselves of special services. Now, if I put up the original chart, we'd all be here all day because it reads like an eye chart. If you look at the manual that actually goes with it, it's like this big. So we reproduce this, hopefully nobody takes any offense. But we're going to be focusing on the section to the right where it says x4, and that's the actual platoons themselves. We're going to talk about the service section, we're going to talk about the canteen and exchange section, and I always try to dismiss the first lieutenant, so we're not going to talk about the platoon headquarters. All right, personnel. Once again, personnel were trained by the Army to do it the Army way. They were trained in the areas of athletics, entertainment to include music, theatrical productions, radio, and motion picture, not production, but presentation. They were also responsible, especially the librarians in the organization, for information and education. They had a field library. They were also responsible for staying on top of educational opportunities in theater and for doing publications such as camp newspapers. We're going to break all this down. You see the big decompositions? Everybody seeing this? All right, we're good too quick. You're not seeing it? Oh, you can see it, okay. Just want to make sure. I can slow this down. I'm used to working with PFCs. Okay. And then they had a canteen and field exchange section. Now, I'm not going to go through the military specialties, but just to let you know, there is some rigor to this. So we threw up three of the functions that would have been performed within the company, and that's the multi-lith or multi-graph operators. Everybody remember that? Okay. For you young people, that's what they had before Xerox.
I don't remember it.
You don't? I can see the ink on your hands. They had music technicians. One of the most famous was Dave Brubeck. Yeah, we can tell you a story about that later on. And theatrical technicians. Now, back in the 1940s, and this is based on the manual from 1944, they did have the military occupational specialties, or MOS. So MOSs go all the way back to the Second World War, just in case you're wondering. Okay. So who had an MOS here? Just me? Okay. Moving on. All right. All of the equipment that was used by the special service companies was broken down into kits. And we're going to talk about the kits and how they apply to the different functions that the special service company provided. Matter of fact, what was funny is I had Bubba proving this last night. He goes, wow, we had kits? And I said, yes, we did. So there was sports and games, athletic equipment, radio photograph equipment, public address equipment, an actual field library, musical instruments and accessories, and that's for daytime, not nighttime operational hours. Theatrical equipment and supplies, printing and publishing, and projectors and motion picture equipment. The great thing about it is the Army, we don't have one. We have never been able to get our hands on one because I think they all sort of kind of disappeared as surplus after the war. But we're going to show you a picture later on how all of this stuff fits on the back of a Doosan half. Does anybody know what a Doosan half is? Yes? 2.5-ton truck, right? And a trailer. Really? You learning anything today? If not, I'm going home. I can be, okay. All right. Moving on. Okay, athletics and physical fitness. The whole idea behind special services companies was not to so much do it yourselves, it was to engage the troops. The whole impetus behind our being is morale and welfare, to engage you, to bring the equipment to the field, to bring the books to the field, to do formal games such as football and baseball. We coordinated boxing tournaments. Matter of fact, I have a pair of special services boxing gloves at home that I use on Bubba when he gets out of line. Also, board games. I mean, it's just incredible. If we showed you the actual, what's called the table of equipment, where the toe, as the military used to call it, it's another eye chart. Okay? But this is pretty much the high level. So as you can see, there's a sports and games equipment for things that we're very familiar with, volleyball and all of that. But then it also breaks down to athletic equipment, okay? So we can lay out fields. We have instructional booklets that you're more than welcome to take a look at over on the table, all right? We have basketballs, baseball, sports books, boxing gloves, et cetera. If you can name it, and it exists in 1944, the Special Services Company probably has one of it. And we're emphasizing universal participation. Now here's a picture. What's really odd about this, the reason a lot of people haven't heard about special services is A, the USO outshines us. Don't ask me why, maybe it's something to do with Bob Hope. But it's very hard to find information or pictures from the field about special services companies. I was very fortunate to find the manuals. So the pictures you're gonna see today, most of them are right out of the manuals. So this picture is of equipment kit A1, which is athletic equipment. As you can see, it comes in two boxes, and you can recognize some stuff even for today. Baseball bats and basketballs and all sorts of fun stuff. So we drag that out, and we coordinate the games, and you guys get to play along, and hopefully takes your mind off the war for just a little while. Okay, field entertainment. This is where people get really confused about us in Camp Shows Inc., which is the overseas arms of the USO. Our goal is to bring out musical instruments and song books and teach you how to play if you have time, okay? Or engage you in things like sing-alongs or, you know, singing around the campfire or just GI sing-along shows, which is what we're trying to bring a little bit forward today. But the whole idea behind the field entertainment approach is more on execution of shows and engaging the troops and actually being the show. Wow, what a novel concept. So when the USO rolls out, they bring out the stars, they put them on the stage. We've already set up the equipment for them, by the way, because quite often they call on us to do their electrical and stage management, okay? And they entertain you. Our goal is to get the troops, get them trained up a little bit, and have them entertain themselves. Okay. All right, so what we've also showed here, and there's a bunch of examples on the tables, we actually have scripts that they provide us for soldiers' show guides. And let me tell you, you're better off writing your own material sometimes. It's pretty dry, okay? But you know, I think First Lieutenant write all that stuff. Yeah. All right. Also, looking at theatrical production, if you've ever been involved in the theater, okay, you know there are a number of different roles that are involved in the theater. We have the manuals, and we will train each and every one of you who want to participate in the next soldier show, okay, to be the show. Just sign up with us afterwards. All right?
Are you serious?
Yeah, we actually travel around doing shows. We just don't have enough guys to pull off a full theatrical production.
Are women involved in these shows?
They're not allowed in the barracks, that's all I can say. Actually, we've not been able to find any information relative to female participation in the special services program. So once again, the special services company used a number of different kits. There was a radio phonograph. We actually have a phonograph. We just don't have it with us. So if you want to see some more artifacts, get over to the Maryland Veterans Memorial Museum. We have a very nice display over there that breaks this down just a little bit more, along with photographs and records and more programs and things of that nature. Does anybody know where that is? You do? Okay. So share with everybody on your way out today so you can all go down and check it out. It's a great museum and a great bunch of people. All right. For theatrical, like I was saying earlier, we got everything to kit you out and provide your own entertainment. Also, we have motion picture equipment. We're still looking for a projector. So if anybody can get your hands on a 1940s Army projector, let us know. We'd love to hear from you. At the time we ship out, we're pretty much given everything we need to hit the ground running. And then it's up to us once we get in theater to reach out to other special services companies or other organizations to make sure that we can supplement the equipment that we have. Because if you've ever been shipped overseas on a troop ship, you know there's only so much room. So they only give you what you can carry. Okay? So moving on. All right, I show this picture to people and they're like, oh my God, he's not wearing a shirt. That can't be the real Army. Anyway, believe it or not, this is in the official publication. This is one of the soldiers in the organization along with a special services member using the public address system and the radio. I think it's a lot nicer than what we have. Yeah. Here's the musical equipment, kit D, or part of it. As you can see, the soldiers are singing along with the guy playing the piano, who I assume is the Special Services Company member. Now, in order to be the lead for the entertainment section of the platoon, you have to be able to play the piano. So you can't just sign up and say, hey, I want to lead that section. You have to actually be able to play the piano. So I told Bubba last night he's got 6 months to learn. All right, here's another picture from the manual that I sort of kind of, I love the pictures that they pick because they're just, you look at it going, that's the Army? This is actually them putting on a theatrical production. For the best that I can tell, it's either in the Pacific or they're doing something relative to indigenous Polynesian populations. Not to know to figure out which. But the special services member that you see on the left actually has the makeup kit. It actually fit around your neck like a mechanic's apron. And he's kitting out one of the troopers who I'm assuming is going to be going on stage in just a couple minutes and rattling off some Frank Sinatra. This is a picture from the manual that shows the two AMPRO projectors. What I love about this picture is that I have a lot of people in my family, half my family's Polynesian, and the Army actually is portraying a Polynesian in the picture, so I'm very happy about that. The reason I bring it up, The special services were one of the few integrated areas of the U.S. Army during the Second World War. Most people of Asiatic descent were actually put off in separate organizations because of this perceived fear that even if you're an American, if you're Asiatic, you pose a threat. So I love that picture. These are some pictures from our company, the 34th Special Service Company. This was in Italy. And as you can see up on the left-hand side, those are the two AMPRO projectors. Now, why do we have two? Anybody want to take a guess? What's that?
It was fixed down.
Well, that's true, but I got to be able to fix it. Back in the old days, films did not run at the same length they do now. They had what were called two or three reel films, which means that once the first reel ran out, you had to be able to start the second one immediately. So I'm assuming that based on the configuration, the most that we can handle is a two reel production. Okay? So the one on the left would be the primary, and once that reel is done, then we go ahead and default to the second one. If it was a third loop, we'd have to reload the first one. Okay. And you hope the light bulb doesn't go out. All right. We also have four librarians. We have a field library, approximately 2,000 volumes. 100 of them are hardbound, and 1,900 of them are clothbound, or could be Army Special Services editions. If you haven't seen a special service, could you grab a special service edition off the table? Has anybody been down to the Bayside History Museum recently? Okay. Did you get a chance to take a look at the library's books reading in the military exhibit on the first floor? All right, we're all taking a field trip after this presentation. Okay. So what Bubba's holding out is a copy of an Armed Services edition. We're going to talk about them in just a couple of minutes. We actually have an exhibit that's dedicated to the American Library Association and the military. But we also have a rather nice exhibit of Armed Service editions. These were novels and books that were condensed down to reading size so that you could actually carry them in your pocket. And a lot of our field library consists of these Armed Service editions. Okay, and there's a, that almost, you know what that looks like? That looks, I'm sharing this with Bubba. Do you mind if I take a moment? We're related, I'm a squad leader, it's okay. That looks like what I built for the magazine stand.
That's pretty close.
That is pretty close. So this is a typical library in the field. As you can see, it's hinged in the middle. It's two or three sections, and we can fit 2,000 books on it. That's what they tell me. What's that?
Very portable.
I know.
Awesome. I want one.
I could build you one.
Great.
Yeah, $29.95 down and $99.95 a month. Until you get tired of paying. I think we'll be there. Okay. Sold your newspapers. Wow. I don't think your computer likes my thoughts. But we'll fix that later. Okay, the typo is not intentional. But the bottom line is, if you're familiar with publications of World War II, everybody knows Stars and Stripes, the Daily. Okay? Everybody knows Yank, the Weekly. Well, the Special Services Company is going to come out, and we're going to work with you, and we're going to draft people out of the organization to do reporters and copy and paste up and art. And we're going to help you put together your own camp newspaper. Unfortunately, the examples I have are over in Bell Alton right now, right? But if you've ever been in the military, or if you have parents, grandparents, do we have any great people that have great-grandparents? Great-grandparents, okay, just want to make sure. They may have down in their footlockers a copy of a camp paper. And if they were in the Army, there's a good possibility that Special Services Company helped put it together. So in addition to drafting talent out of the troops that they serviced, they also interfaced with other people in the theater to include special services officers, athletic and recreation officers, morale services. They got news flashes from everywhere. We're gonna talk a little bit about that in just a moment. It's such a diverse, I'm gonna let you read this, because if I read through it, I'll fall asleep, then you'll fall asleep. The intent here really is, there's only so much time and so much space. Okay, but we want to just show you the immediacy and at least give you the impression of what the service company did. Now the thing is too, they got their own printing and publishing kit, so everything you need for at least two weekly editions came with it. After that, you got to go see the quartermaster. So from the paper to the ink to the stencils to the lithograph or multi-lith machines to everything that you need to put up together a camp paper, we're going to be there to do it for you. So if you have any interesting articles that you'd like to see published, let us know. This is a special services company librarian. I know he's a librarian. How do I know that? Because he's operating a typewriter. Okay? And this device you see over to the right of the table, right here, that looks like one of the, it looks like one of the old tabletop mailboxes, is the multi-lith machine. And there are some examples of what they're punching out to the right-hand side of the desk. So everything was done in, could you imagine trying to put together your company's newspaper or newsletter under these kind of conditions? Okay. Camp Newspaper Service. Well, you can't do anything on your own. You need to reach out to other people. There was a centralized organization called the Camp Newspaper Service. They were in the Morale Services Division, which is one of our sister organizations within our branch of the military. And they would put out weekly clip sheets. This had news features and other art materials that we could use as soldier newspapers because, as you know, things get quite boring around the camp. Nobody wants to read about it twice. So we would reach out to them. They would give us comic strips such as Milk Caniff's Mail Call. Does anybody know who Milk Caniff is? Has anybody ever heard of Terry and the Pirates? Okay. Well, Milk Caniff is the guy that drew Terry and the Pirates, and Mail Call was his version of Terry and the Pirates, and it was done specifically for the military. They also had service cartoons. If you've ever read a copy of Yank or Stars and Stripes, you'll see some cartoons in there about military life, too many to even try to bring up. And I just found out about this. I did not know about this. A little feature called GI Galley, which was the Army's attempt at humorously portraying how to do things. Think about Private Snafu in a comic strip. Information and education. As we were talking about earlier, we're not only here to entertain or help you put together a newspaper, okay? We have to be informed because we got to inform you, and part of our mission is actually to educate the troops that we service. So in order to do that, we would reach out to the education branch of the Morale Services Division along with the information branch, and we'd utilize services such as the Overseas News. I can never say that. You want to try it? Okay. The Overseas News Service. It's too alliterative for me. From that service, they would actually cable out daily information to the commanding general of the theater of operations. Our job was to get a hold of a copy of it and try to distill it down and include it in the camp newspapers at an appropriate level for the troops. We were also tuned into radio information and entertainment programs. We're responsible for knowing which AFN stations are in the area, what their call sign is, what their frequency is, and from that, we could use our audiovisual equipment to broadcast those radio broadcasts out to the troops within the company. And quite often, because we have four audiovisual kits, we're able to do that at various places around the base. Now, a lot of people may or may not know about the AFN. We're not going to talk about it today because it's a whole other separate branch and we take a whole other separate presentation of the special services. But they produce two types of programming. One was commercial broadcasts, things that you would have heard on the home front, such as, let's see. Oh, you know, I was thinking about you the other day when I was thinking about this.
Sorry.
Yeah. Actually, I was looking at Grace Mary when I said that. Right. So Burns and Allen, Jack Benny, okay, those programs were rebroadcast overseas. The difference was they took out all of the advertising. Why? Because the Army is a not-for-profit entity. If you've ever bought a $450 hammer, you understand why. Right. They also had specially produced programs that they did. Some of the most fondly remembered are programs such as Command Performance, and Mail Call and Jubilee, which were mainly music-based. The Army also did its own educational radio broadcast. Thank God they're not on until 10 o'clock tonight. Okay, I put a whole special slide aside because I've seen these news maps before. This was another source of information we're putting together, the camp newspaper. If you've never seen one, They're poster size. They're like 24, 36. They're two-sided. They're done for different theaters of operation to have information about what's going on, how we're winning the war, and other information that may be of interest that, as a trooper, you may not have access to. So we gave it its own page only because I like them so much. So if you get a chance, there actually is a couple places online, if you're interested, where you can go see these. They're, remember back in elementary school, what was it, Weekly Reader would send out the posters once? This is like Weekly Readers for the troops. Okay, I'm glad I could connect with this audience. Normally I'm talking to people, they're like, what the heck's that old man talking about? All right, if you want to get educated, we can do that too, because we have to keep up on top of Army Correspondence courses. If you want to learn how to run basic radio, we can do that for you. You want to learn a foreign language? If you need visual instruction, films, film strips, all of that, see me. I'm your librarian. I can help you. I love librarians. There you are. Yay! All right. Let's give a big hand for librarians. Because as far as the special services go, the library is the crux of education and information for the troops. If you want to teach yourself because you get tired of hearing me talk, you can do that too. And the picture on the right hand, we actually have one of these. And it's pretty cool because you can go through and you can help qualify yourself for what you want to learn. If you're working on a promotion, if you want to get a transfer, you want to get a transfer?
No, I like it here.
Okay. If you want to get a transfer, if you want to move on to the next thing, or we're winning the war, so if you want to prepare for civilian life, because we're going to be done by Christmas, okay, the Army can help you with that. Just see us, and we'll hook you up with some educational programs.
Thanks.
You're welcome. All right, we're going to pay some homage to the Canteen and Exchange Service. So, the bottom line is the manual says, we have to prepare the list of available equipment. We have to get our supplies from a reputable dealer, normally the quartermaster. We have to maintain, it's just like running an exchange today or a small store, okay? In addition to running a canteen. So a canteen, just so nobody gets confused, is not like the civilian version, the Hollywood canteen where we have stars and a big stage and all of that kind of stuff. It's mainly a snack bar at the end of the, end of the exchange where you can get a nice sandwich and maybe a hot bowl of soup on a good day. Can you believe, you know, I was reading through this the other day as I was proofing this, right? And the Army actually had to come out and say that we have to protect merchandise against pilferage and breakage. Can you believe it? Anyway, that's the one thing that jumped out at me. But we're here, if it's issue, you can't get it at the exchange. This is all the other things, toothpaste, shaving, soap, all those kind of things that the Army does not issue, but you're gonna need, okay? Come see us, the exchange is open at 0700 to 1700 hours daily, except for Sunday, because they make us go to church. Okay. All right, remember I was telling you earlier that all these kits fit real nicely in the back of a deuce and a half in a trailer? This is how it all loads. I don't know if you can see that from the back, but everything has a place and a place for everything. I love this picture only because once a year we go on bivouac, and I'm responsible for loading the truck. So I love this picture. Actually, if you were in the Navy or the Air Force, they would call it a load plane. Somebody nodded back there.
So they have these things in each division, each military?
We have been able to identify 38 special services companies. The Navy actually had a counterpart. It was not as robust as the Army from what we can tell. As a matter of fact, I've been able to find very little. And the Marine Corps also had a morale and welfare organization, but we've not been able to nail down a lot of information on that either.
Army Air Force?
They were part of the Army. Yep. As a matter of fact, if you go on the table, I believe we had something from the 7th Army Air Force and a special services production. All right, Special Services alumni of World War II. We actually have a whole set of pictures and info. It's really good reading. However, we wanted to stick with World War II. We talked about Clint Eastwood earlier. We said he wasn't in World War II, so don't ask. All right. But when I was going through this, because I went ahead and finalized this yesterday, because I want to make sure it's still fresh in my head, we tried to pick, these are not all of the alumni who went on to motion pictures and stage and TV during World War II. We tried to pick those that young people would be most familiar with, at least we hope. All right, So for all you young people out there, Burt Lancaster was not just a trapeze artist, but a very well-respected actor of both stage and screen. Sammy Davis Jr., love that man. Dancing Fool, Sing, Dance, TV, part of the Rat Pack. You guys heard of the Rat Pack? No?
Yes.
Well, I know you have. I'm looking at the young people. No? Okay. They're looking at me. Dick Van Dyke started out as an announcer, went to special services. When he was dancing on his TV show, where do you think he learned it?
In the Army.
But luckily he didn't do it the Army way. Werner Kempler, Colonel Klink, was part of the Army Special Services, along with Don Knotts. Everybody remembers Don Knotts, right? From the Andy Griffith Show. Okay, and later on, Three's Company? Yes. And he also, guess what was on yesterday? The Ghost of Mr. Chicken. I immediately went to Turner Classic Movies.
Okay.
Limpet, I love that movie. It hasn't come out yet, but I love that movie. Okay, so while not part of special services companies, these are the things that people ask about the most when it comes to special services. So we figured we'd throw in a couple slides. We talked a little bit earlier about the ASCs, the special publications. There are also handicraft guides that were printed by Mechanics Illustrated and used by special services or handicraft sessions. Also in doing special services, quite often coordinate with the medical officer in theater to do rehab and help guys to use their fingers again, or if they had any kind of catastrophic injury, to help them recover while in theater until they could be evac'd back home. We were talking earlier about you want to learn a foreign language. Well, we can't teach you a foreign language, but we do have pocket guides, okay? And these were printed up for, I think it was like 25 different places. And what's funny is, Alaska is listed as basically a foreign country. As is Hawaii, by the way. Okay? All right, V-discs. Everybody's seen a V-disc. And if you haven't, that's okay too. V-discs were a special publication of the Morale and Welfare branch of the U.S. Army. They were re-recordings of popular music and all different kinds of genres. Normally when people think about World War II, the only thing they think about is swing music. V-disc covered everything from folk music to classical music. Matter of fact, some great classical music. Arturo Toscanini, one of my favorite on V-disc. And good morning. Your normal pop and swing, great jazz, some real live, great live jazz recordings on V-disc, but they covered every genre. Why is that? Because there's every genre of person in the military. Hit kits. We talked a little bit earlier about encouraging to sing along. Okay. So there's two versions of the hit kit. One was a full-size publication that had all the words and the chords and everything, so that Bubba 6 months from now will be able to sit down at the piano and play for you and you can sing along. And the other was a little pocket edition. It was about the size of a note card almost. Unfortunately, all of ours are on exhibit. But they would give everyone a pocket-sized hit kit at mail call. The reason being, they wanted everybody to make sure they walked away from mail call with something in their pocket. Okay. All right. We're going to do a little quiz. This is a quiz from the last. How many people came to the last show? You did. Two people. Okay. So hopefully you don't remember the answers.
I don't remember anything.
All right. So we're going to do a little quiz here, okay? And you can just shout out the answers. Bubba and I always emphasize the difference between nostalgia and history, okay? We love history, and we like to share and try to educate. Most people, when they remember back, it's more of a nostalgic thing. Okay, so that's our take on nostalgia versus history. So, with that, according to most sources, see how good you really are, okay? What was the most popular song of World War II among GIs?
Bugle Boy?
Nope. Only hit number 6 in 1940.
Who?
Oh, I was just saying, it wasn't as big as people thought it was in. Anybody else want to take a guess? So we got Boogie Woogie Bugle Boy.
Don't Sit Under the Apple Tree?
Nope. Same group, but no.
White Christmas?
Nope.
Here
Mercy Dokes?
Nope. Though I love the Merrimacks. Anybody else?
Probably Glenn Miller Big Band sound.
No. As a matter of fact, you know what's funny is In the Mood was actually released in 1939. But they carried it over in the Hollywood iteration of the song, all right.
Over there?
Now you're going way back. Wrong war. We'll be back to talk about that next year. That was a war.
Sunshine? Well, it could have been a rerun.
Something to do with Coming Back Home?
Unfortunately,
the
not.
The White Cliffs of Dover?
No. All right. Lily Marlene. By Marlena Dietrich. And what I always tell people about that song is it is so slow that it reminds me of a funeral dirge. Okay? And I refuse to program. However, the theme of it is an American soldier meeting with his girl under the lamplight. Okay, so it's very nostalgic. It's sort of kind of funny. It's like I was saying, the difference between history, which is the reality of the fact that that was the most popular song among GIs, and nostalgia, which gives basically every answer that everybody's given up to that point. Okay. All right. We have four pictures here, and here's what I need to know, and you can just shout it out, okay? You can crawl over the top of each other if you want. Can you spot the real performers? I'm talking period-wise. They're all performers. But which ones are from the World War II era? Yeah. Top left, okay, that's a camp shows unit in Italy during 1943, okay? Anybody else want to take a guess? Bottom right? Nope, that's actually me with a lady that portrays Lana Turner at an event 4 years ago.
Top right.
That's actually a retro group. I don't know what their names are. Okay, there's one more picture.
Is it real? Bottom left.
Real or not real?
Not real.
Oh, it is. It's the Castro sisters from 1955 on tour with the USO. So you did okay. You did 50-50.
Were they
Q4 too? Were they? No, they were Italiano. They did a song called Teach Me Tonight. That was a big hit. She's like, yeah, I'm going to look that up as soon as we get home. Nine. Okay, so moving on. Questions? Yes?
When you would go to a theater, how long would you typically stay in that location?
Until they tell us to move. So it could be, no, seriously. It could be 2 months, it could be 3 months. We're following the front.
Okay.
So the thing about organizations in World War II in the military, even as an infantryman assigned to a company, assigned to a division, assigned to a battalion, you could be in another division or battalion 2 weeks from now. Because we're constantly reorganizing. So the goal really is to put us wherever needed the most. Okay, and that's why we could be assigned at any level. And the higher the level, the more troops we have to support. But based on the information that we've seen and the amount of time it actually takes to engage troops and teach them up on some things, I'd like to think it wasn't less than 5 or 6 months, but we can't find any records. We're actually planning a trip to the archives because the manuals don't tell you how long you're going to be where you're going to be. Okay. Yes?
This is kind of a multi-level question.
Okay.
How many people were in each
company?
A division or
okay, within a special services company.
And how many of those were scattered around?
Well, there's 109 in the company, and there's 4 platoons. So a platoon would be assigned based on what level of the organization we're assigned to. So we're assigned at the company level, there's going to be 1 platoon for every 25 guys. And as the organization size increases, depending on how we're aligned, the number of troops we have to support will increase based on those numbers. I believe you had your hand up next.
So
hi, Jeanette.
Hello there. Thank you for inviting me. What was the age range? You know, the troops.
The troops themselves or the special services company?
Special services.
Anywhere from, well, let me put it this way. Because they were recruiting people who were active in entertainment or theatrical production, the normal age range for the draft was 18 to 45.
Okay.
Okay. Most of your younger talent who wasn't already in the service, the age range that I've seen so far based on the personal information we know with the five is like 18 to 25. And your company commander may be a little bit older. We had a question in the back.
So let's take that way. So
okay.
they're troop land and they're taking one of the Germans all the way up to the peninsula.
Right.
And these companies are going with the action. So are they in the rear, far away from the fight? So the troops cycle out.
We're going to be in the rear
they echelon. How many weeks do people have off fight to be entertained or to do this? I mean, what's going on logistically to make this actually work in the field?
Well, it, like I said, based on the depth of engaging the troops, I'm going to go, and the funny thing is, we've not been able to find any records or pictures that special services companies were deployed to North Africa, or to Sicily, or to the Italian theater. Everything we've seen so far is that they were engaged in Europe and throughout the Pacific. Like I said, the manuals don't really get in, and a lot of what we're doing is because we're just not able to find, I think we've met one guy in the 10 years we've been doing this who was actually in special services. He was a weatherman on AFN Berchtesgaden right after the Second World War. So we would actually be a rear echelon. We would probably be at the organization level where it's the most stable, which is going to be at the battalion or brigade level. And because of everything that we're doing, and let me put it this way, if we were like a Camp Chose, we would be packing the truck every night and going to the next phase and then came the next day. But as we've seen through what was presented today, our goal is to engage you, which means you're probably fairly stable. You're not in the rear echelon on leave. So it's really hard to say. I mean, it's just no basis of estimate.
It sounds like, not knowing anything about this, but it sounds like to do the whole mission, they were doing that for headquarters staff, people who are behind, logistics support
right.
people. And they're not out front because there's people coming off the combat and trying to engage them in doing theater. It's not going to work.
Right.
I mean,
and there's a couple different ways to look at this. Okay, so let's say you're a combat infantryman, you're off the line for 2 weeks. Okay, well, I probably can't hook you up with a reporter to do the camp newspaper. Probably can't get you involved in theatrical productions, and probably can't get you to do a stage show for me. However, you can come to the library, you can partake of the canteen in the exchange, okay? And we'd love to have you come down and play the piano for us because Bubba's still learning. So even if you were in rear echelon, because of the multifaceted services that we provide, everybody in theater would be able to engage some aspect of it. Yes?
What was your most rustic accommodations when you were abroad?
Let's see, we slept on the floor.
So you had something over your head?
Not always.
So what was really the most rustic?
Sleeping out in the rain under a poncho.
Where?
Well, let's see. It could have been Bristol that night after we got out of the pub.
That was the ditch, though.
Oh, that was the ditch. Yes, because it helped my back.
Right.
Yeah. No, coming through, we came in through Normandy, and we were stuck for a couple weeks waiting to move forward, and our equipment was actually back on the LST. So we slept in the cab. Well, the drivers got to sleep in the cabs of the truck. We crawled underneath the truck with the tarps.
And the second part of that, when you were, did you go to Polynesia at all, like Hawaii and stuff?
No, we would be in one theater. So special services companies would be assigned to either the Pacific or the European Theater of Operations.
So you weren't in the Pacific?
No.
If you had been, could you have visited, like taken a day off to see a relative or something? Did they go to visit any family members when they were
there? Well, there's all sorts of records of people being in theater, especially because I have Italian family. And as we were working up from the boot, right, they would actually go through villages where they had extended family and stop and see them as time allowed, because you don't want to be off duty. You don't want to be anywhere.
So
yeah.
There was time to go on small.
It really depends on what theater you were in and where you were at and what your mission was. Yes. Really?
Do you know during the Battle of the Bulge if any of the special companies actually got trapped or involved?
Actually, it's funny you should ask that. Because in addition to the USO, Camp Chose, Inc., and Special Services, there were other organizations that played music in theater. As a matter of fact, I picked up a very interesting book last year about one of these one-off organizations. They were in the Army Air Force. They came out of Columbus, Ohio. They deployed together. They were in the National Guard and got federalized. I cannot remember the name of the group, but it was almost like a full orchestra, and they had their own bus and toured all over overseas. Two of them were actually captured during the Battle of the Bulge, but when the Germans got pushed back, they were able to get away. So no records of Special Service Company members, but we do have records of two musicians being captured. I think the last time we were captured, the Germans gave us back. Yeah. Any other questions? That was it? All right, well, we have a special treat for you. You want to sing along with Spam? Do we have enough time? We got enough time. You want to sing along with Spam and Bubba?
Sure.
Oh, heck, why not? I got nowhere else to be today. Anyway, look, before we go, how'd you like the presentation?
Yeah.
Well, if anybody would like a copy, you can email us at spamtime, which is the name of our show, at email.com, and we'll send you a copy. Okay? You also have autographed 8x10s in the lobby. Somebody stole them.
No, I got them.
All right. Anyway, in the true spirit of the special services companies, you have the lyrics, we have the music, and we'll hope you sing along. When you're smiling, when you're smiling, the whole world smiles at you. When you're laughing, yes, when you're laughing, the sun comes shining through. But when you're crying, you bring on the rain, so stop that crying. Come on, get happy again. Cause when you're smiling, yes, when you're smiling, the whole world smiles at you. When you're smiling, when you're smiling, the whole world smiles at you. When you're laughing, yes, when you're laughing, the sun comes shining through. When you're crying, you bring on the rain, so stop the crying. Come on, get happy again. Cause when you're smiling, yes, when you're smiling, the whole world smiles at you. Alright, like you're auditioning. When you're smiling, when you're smiling, the whole world smiles at you. When you're laughing, yes, when you're laughing, the sun comes shining through. But when you're crying, you bring on the rain, so stop that crying. Come on, get happy again, cause when you're smiling, yes, when you're smiling, the whole you're sounding good. All right. Oh, thank you so much. Right now, remember we were talking a little bit earlier, and we said that there's a great diversity in music that was available to the troops. We're going to do a little country western for you right now. Drinking beer in a cabaret, and was I having fun? Until one night she caught me right, and now I'm on the run. Lay that pistol down, babe, lay that pistol down. Pistol back in my mouth, lay that pistol down. She kicked in my windshield, she hit me over the head. She cussed and cried and said I lied, and she wished that I was dead. Lay that pistol down, babe, lay that pistol down. Pistol back in my mind, lay that pistol down. You can dance among yourself if you want. Drinking beer in a cabaret and dancing with a blonde, until one night she shut out the light and bang, that blonde was gone. Lay that pistol down, babe, lay that pistol down. Pistol back in mama, lay that pistol down. I love you every night, dear, I woo you every day. I'll be your regular daddy if you put that gun away. Lay that pistol down, babe, lay that pistol down. Pistol back in mama, lay that pistol down. We don't get the influences, by the way. Here we go. Drinking beer in a cabaret, and was I having fun? Until one night she caught me right, and now I'm on the run. Lay that pistol down, babe, lay that pistol down. Pistol back in mama, lay that pistol down. Now there was old Stan Turner, he loved to have his fun. But she got some lead and shot him dead, now talking days are done. Lay that pistol down, babe, lay that pistol down. Pistol back in mama, lay that pistol down. Ah-ha! Oh, thank you so much. We get time for one more. Okay. What are we doing next? Oh, okay. All right, does anybody know this one? Oh, good, I'll let you sing. Hey! It's you! Alright. That's what we sing for the Commonwealth. It's an old English ditty.
My foolish heart.
Bayside History Museum, Grace Mary presiding, the Calvert Library Association, all the citizens of Calvert County for your continued support for the productions that Bubba and I put on, everybody for being here today. Till we meet again, take care, God bless, love you.